to keep her with us, and we're just gonna miss her every day.
I still feel that I'm in nightmare.
I can remember many times just being in awe of the fact that I knew this man.
Heartbreak from family and friends continuing to share stories about their loved ones and concerns about the aircraft they died in. It's been 2 days since a deadly Ethiopian Airlines crash took 157 lives, including 18 Canadians. And since then, questions about the safety of Boeing 737 MAX 8 planes have prompted dozens of countries to ground them and close their airspace to the aircraft. Here are some of them. Just this afternoon, the European Aviation Safety Agency also announced they'd be grounding the aircrafts and banning them from their airspace. Still, U.S. and Canadian authorities maintain they'll keep the planes in the air.
It's important for us not to jump to conclusions, but to evaluate in a very objective and logical way what happened. At the moment, we have no information whatsoever to lead us to any hypothesis, and yet there are many possible causes of this tragic accident. So we are in the data gathering mode. We're looking for information. We're talking to all the experts, not only in Canada, but also in the United States.
One of the last 737 MAX 8s to get out of the UK before it closed its airspace to the planes was an Air Canada flight to Halifax. CBC News spoke to some of the passengers when they arrived a little earlier this afternoon.
Well, you know, I think the pilot wouldn't fly it or the crew wouldn't be in it if it was banned.
A little worried, but once you're up there, there's nothing you can do, so there's no point to dwell on it too much.
There's lots of them, hundreds of them flying. They don't know what caused, as far as I know, the last crash, so accidents happen.
Now the investigation into the cause of the crash is entering a new stage. A recovery effort is winding down, and some families of some of the victims are still arriving at the site. At the same time, the technical investigation is intensifying. CBC senior correspondent Susan Ormiston is at the scene of the crash outside Addis Ababa.
These are some of the last sweeps of this area where the plane came down on Sunday. These are forensic teams painstakingly looking through the disturbed earth for any last remaining body parts or passengers' belongings, which are so critical now to the surviving family. Over here you can see a lot of mangled airplane parts which have been dug out of a crater just beyond that ridge of soil. The force of the plane plunging into the earth buried some of the fuselage, so teams have had to dig it out of the earth. This will form part of the reconstruction of the plane. The teams are coming from all over the world, the FAA, Boeing, Ethiopian Airlines. Also, Interpol is involved with the identification now, and we learned that the RCMP is assembling a team as well. We spoke to one man, a family member, who came here. His brother died in the crash. Israel has sent its own ID team, hoping to get anything, any remainder of his brother that they can bury. He said it was so important to them. You know, we know now that this flight only lasted 6 minutes in the air, but this is really a world apart from where it took off in the Addis Ababa airport. This is in the middle of rural Ethiopia, and every day hundreds and hundreds of Africans have walked from villages around here just to come and see the site and reflect on the fact this now is sacred ground. Susan Ormiston, CBC News, 65 kilometers outside Addis Ababa.
Sunday's crash killed people from 35 countries. All 18 Canadians have now been identified. The final three to be named are 72-year-old Amin Ismail Noor Mohammed from the Toronto area. Don Tanner was a 47-year-old Hamilton area teacher. The last Canadian to be named is Ruby Pauls, a 9-month-old baby. Four members of her family were also on the flight, and like a handful of other international victims, they had close ties to Canada, although they were not Canadian citizens. Our Ali Shiasan has spent the day looking at the stories from around the GTA. Ali, 8 victims came from our area.
That's right. There are many here in the greater Toronto Hamilton area mourning from afar. With 157 people on board, this crash became also an international tragedy.
Toronto activist Parvati Devi spoke to her friend Darcy Bélanger the Friday before he left. The two used to work to raise awareness of melting polar ice. He was in Africa for a United Nations conference.
He was able to touch almost every portfolio within our organization, an all-volunteer not-for-profit, and he was able to bring things to the finish line like a quarterback.
Stephanie Lacroix, originally from Timmins, Ontario, was also passionate about the environment and was also on that flight.
I know that we're gonna do what we can to keep her with us, and we're just gonna miss her every day.
Kerry aged 4, and 9-month-old Ruby.
The youngest Canadian to have died in the crash is 9-month-old Ruby Pauls. Her mother and siblings had moved to Ontario before she was born. They all died together en route to visit their grandfather for Easter. Their life story broadcast on Kenyan News. Manant Veda of Brampton also almost lost his entire family.
I'm speechless. I mean, of course, there are 3 generations.
Dawn Tanner, an educator from Hagersville Secondary near Hamilton, is being mourned by her 2 sons on Facebook. One of them, Cody French, says, "Mom, I can't begin to explain how much I miss you and how different life will be without your beautiful laugh and your tight hugs. But I just want you to know that both Hunter and I are so proud of you for helping out the vulnerable and pursuing your dreams." Even though 18 Canadian lives came to an end here, their memory is being kept alive around the world and at home. In Toronto's Ethiopian community, that can mean a Buna ceremony.
When we're making the coffee and we're, you know, putting down the incense and firing that up, we drink this 3 times. It's bitter.
Yeah.
This is Ethiopian, Eritrean way of honoring those who are coming into the world as a newborn and honoring those who are leaving.
Closure is going to be a long process. Some families will travel abroad to identify remains and belongings. Airlines usually pay for those travel expenses, and sometimes insurers do. Then you have that emotional process, of course, of bringing the remains back to Canada. Dwight.
Thank you, Ali. A small plane came down this afternoon at Buttonville Airport. The pilot is fine, and what happened is now under investigation, of course. Now, York Regional closed the on and off ramps from Highway 404 to 16th Avenue. A spokesperson for Buttonville Airport told CBC News it's not an airport issue, it was a pilot issue.
We're here today to announce charges in the largest college admissions scam ever prosecuted by the Department of Justice.
Altered test scores, fake credentials, and a lot of money. 2 Hollywood actresses have been arrested, accused of buying their children's college admissions. More on how the multi-million dollar scheme worked coming up in just a few minutes. The Ford government announced plans today to ban cell phones in schools starting this fall. It's not clear yet just how the plan will be implemented and how much flexibility schools will have when it comes to enforcing the new rules. While teachers and parents mostly seem to support this decision, as you guessed, many students aren't welcoming the news. Rick Ross has more.
It was not the kind of news 15-year-old Tashana Beckford was expecting in the middle of her March break.
Starting in September, cell phones will be banned in the classroom.
Oh. Yeah, they shouldn't do that.
MPP Stephen Lachey says they have to do it because they believe cell phones have become too much of a distraction for students who may be tempted to text or check social media.
They want to make sure the learning is the focus in the classroom.
Lachey says students will be able to bring cell phones into the classroom. They just have to be turned off and put away. But Beckford argues her cell phone is often a valuable learning tool.
Some schools don't have enough technology for all students in their class, so then some of them are going to need their phones to like do the research and stuff.
The province plans to take that into consideration.
If there's an academic purpose, if there's an emergency purpose, a medical purpose, obviously we're going to have that flexibility.
This is not far off the policy the Toronto District School Board already has in place.
We'll have to wait and see exactly what the province does announce to see how our rules, guidelines, policies might have to change, if at all.
That had some political opponents questioning the PC government's motives. In a statement, the Green Party of Ontario said, "Is today's announcement an effort by the Premier to change the dial from the chaos of the autism file?" This TDSB high school teacher calls today's announcement a needed step.
I think that it is a legitimate concern. It's a continual battle that I think myself as a teacher, I'm always fighting to have students put them away so that we can concentrate on the daily lesson.
While she does often use technology in her lessons, Curtis says the biggest challenge will be enforcing the new rules. This grade 9 student agrees.
I don't think kids will follow through with it because like we're already like bringing it to class when we're not supposed to.
But she also admits her cell phone can be a distraction.
You know, I'm very addicted to it, so like if I put it away, I'm probably going to be like, oh, who's texting me, and probably take it back.
You're already worried about that.
Yeah, I am.
The province hasn't said how much flexibility school boards will have in setting guidelines for cell phone use or who will be responsible for enforcing them. Greg Ross, CBC News, Toronto.
The gas station attendant, he was like screaming at me to shut it off.
Because it can cause a fire.
I'll talk on the phone another time, right?
For years, drivers have been told to stay off their cell phones when pumping gas. It could cause a fire, right? Well, maybe not. Coming up at 6:30, why the change in policy and how it could affect how you pay at the pumps. The NHL says Toronto Maple Leafs defenseman Morgan Rielly did not use a homophobic slur against an official during last night's game at Scotiabank Arena. The league launched an investigation shortly after the game ended. Now, Rielly maintained he'd never uttered the slur, which he echoed at a press conference today.
I was 100% confident that I didn't use the word, so we allowed the process to play out. It was difficult at times to not make a statement because how strongly I felt about it. And the fact that it is a very important issue.
The alleged incident happened with less than 2 minutes left in the game against Tampa Bay. Rielly and Tampa Bay's Yanni Gord were skating into the Maple Leafs defensive zone. That's when Rielly was accused of making the comment towards a game official, with television cameras picking up what sounded like an anti-gay slur. Leafs general manager Kyle Dubas says footage from different cameras were reviewed, and it was determined that Rielly did not utter the slur.
First step was, for me, sitting down with Morgan and asking Morgan directly to his face, this is the video, what did you say? And he was unequivocal in his statement that he didn't say that. That word did not leave his mouth. The next part was the NHL, of course, contacting the official Brad Meyer, and the official stating, that did not happen. I did not hear Morgan Rielly say that, and Morgan Rielly did not say that to me.
Players have been disciplined in the past for using homophobic slurs. 2 years ago, Anaheim Ducks captain Ryan Getzlaf was fined $10,000 for using a slur in a playoff game. At the time, the move was criticized for being too lenient.
Oh, Serge Ibaka going after Marquise Chris. Punches are thrown.
Well, there's no doubt about this one, though. Raptors player Serge Ibaka has been suspended 3 games for fighting with Cleveland Cavaliers' Marquise Chris. The NBA says the suspension was due to Ibaka instigating the altercation, throwing a punch, and his past history of fighting during games. Chris, meanwhile, will be suspended for 1 game. It's a scandal of Hollywood proportions involving some Hollywood names. Tonight, Desperate Housewives actress Felicity Huffman and Full House star Laura Loughlin are under arrest. The charge, they, along with dozens of other parents, cheated their children's way into college. Stephen D'Souza has more on the $25 million scheme.
Authorities are calling this Operation Varsity Blues, in which they allege dozens of well-to-do parents bribed, lied, and cheated so that their children could attend some of the most prestigious schools in America. 50 people have been charged, among them 2 Hollywood actresses, as well as a Canadian. There's Felicity Huffman, best known for her role in Desperate Housewives.
5 kids, wow, that sounds like a lot.
Then you'll pop in and get a pelvic ultrasound and then it's off to the wharf.
And Lori Loughlin, she of course played Aunt Becky in Full House and now stars in the drama When Calls the Heart, which airs on CBC.
Make no mistake, this is not a case where parents were acting in the best interests of their children. This is a case where they flaunted their wealth, sparing no expense, to cheat the system so they could set their children up for success with the best education money could buy, literally.
Let me tell you about a young lady by the name of Whitney.
At the heart of this case is an admissions consultant. He allegedly helped parents by getting ringers to take admissions tests or getting insiders to change student scores. Prosecutors say he also bribed coaches and administrators to designate students as elite athletes to fast-track their admissions, sometimes for sports they didn't even play.
Hi!
That's the accusation against Lori Loughlin, that she and her fashion designer husband paid $500,000 for their two daughters to be labeled as part of the rowing team, even though they'd never participated in the sport. Prosecutors say Huffman paid $15,000 disguised as a donation to charity so someone could secretly change the answers on her daughter's entrance exam. The Canadian is former CFLer David Sidhu. He's charged with paying hundreds of thousands of dollars so someone else could take entrance exams for his two sons. His lawyer tells CBC that Sidhu is known for his philanthropy and should be presumed innocent until proven guilty. Now, it should be pointed out that all of the parents were successful in getting the students into the school of their choice, and no students were actually charged today, prosecutors saying in many cases the children had no idea what their parents had done. Stephen D'Souza, CBC News, New York.
Let's check in with Nick now. Nick, it feels like we're still moving in the right direction, buddy.
Yeah, slowly but surely we're getting there. We're expecting double digits headed our way for Thursday. But in advance of that, a slow warm-up. Today we're up to 3 degrees in the GTA. This came under sunny skies, still hanging on to positive temperatures, 2-3 degrees right now across the region, and clear skies as well, light winds. Beautiful day to be outside today. If you missed it today, tomorrow is going to be mild as well, although we'll see a few spotty showers in advance of a system that we're tracking to the southwest. This is what I talked to you about yesterday. Now, tomorrow, the leading edge of this warm front is going to bring with it some spotty showers through the afternoon, and we'll time it out coming up in just a little bit. But the real meat of the system, not coming until Thursday. Now, in advance of this cold front, we'll get strong southerly winds. It's also going to bring with it some heavy rainfall at times, the risk of a thunderstorm, but it all comes with a warm-up. In fact, by Thursday evening, we're looking at temperatures in the double digits. Just barely, but we're there. It doesn't last long. Cold front moves through, and then temperatures start to drop. We'll get to all those details in just a sec. For now, though, we're looking at -4 tonight. Generally light winds. Wind chill of about -7. Tomorrow, 5 degrees, a few spotty showers through the afternoon, and then temperatures start to rise into Thursday. I'll time it out for you coming up in just a little bit, Dwight.
Thanks, Nick.
You bet.
Britain remains in a state of political confusion after its parliament tossed out a revised Brexit deal today. So, what happens next? Killa Hounsell has the details from London.
This is yet another humiliating defeat for Prime Minister Theresa May. Her divorce deal with the European Union has been rejected yet again, this time by 149 votes. You may remember her deal was overwhelmingly rejected in January by 230 votes. And since then, the Prime Minister has been seeking legally binding changes to the Irish backstop. That's the insurance policy that guarantees there will never be a return of a hard border between Ireland and Northern Ireland. And in fact, just last night, the Prime Minister came back to MPs saying she had been able to secure some of the changes they were seeking on that backstop, but clearly it was not enough as she saw her deal rejected yet again. Here's what she had to say.
I profoundly regret the decision that this House has taken tonight. I continue to believe that by far the best outcome is that the United Kingdom leaves the European Union in an orderly fashion with a deal. Yeah. And that the deal we've negotiated is the best and indeed the only deal available. Yeah.
So now the question becomes, what's next? The Prime Minister has said there will now be another vote tomorrow for which MPs will be given a chance to vote on whether they want to leave the European Union on March 29th with no deal. If they reject that as well, then on Thursday they will be given a chance to vote on whether they want to delay Brexit. If they say yes, Brexit will be delayed until June. If they say no, then no one is really sure what will happen. It will be further uncertainty here in the United Kingdom. And this is not just raising questions about how and when Britain will leave the European Union, but also about the Prime Minister's own future. There have already been calls for her to call a general election just since the results of the vote today. So there was a lot riding on this vote, both for the Prime Minister and the United Kingdom. Kayla Hounsell, CBC News, London.
Tina Fontaine's disappearance and death 5 years ago was shocking and heartbreaking. Today, a report revealed what many have known for a long time. The system meant to protect her failed her. Coming up next, more on the report and the recommendations to make sure it never happens to another child.
This was an endemic, systemic, and societal-wide failure for a young woman. We all have a responsibility to play in with what happened to Tina, and therefore we all have a responsibility to find solutions together.
The weather update is brought to you by Train Extreme Conditions Testing. It's hard to stop a train, really hard. Train, the most reliable heating and cooling brand.
The death of 15-year-old Tina Fontaine horrified this country. And nearly 5 years after the Indigenous teen's body was pulled from Winnipeg's Red River, a new report from Manitoba's Children's Advocate lays out how the system failed Fontaine repeatedly. Cameron McIntosh explains.
Sagging First Nation, Tina Fontaine was raised here and laid to rest here. Amid the sound of drums and the smell of burning sweetgrass, a long-anticipated report was released here into the circumstances of her death, offering rare insight into Manitoba's maligned child welfare system.
Barriers to accessing the services were plenty, and overall, the service wasn't delivered to Tina.
Tina Fontaine was just 15 years old when her body was pulled from Winnipeg's Red River in 2014. She became a symbol of violence against Indigenous women and girls, one of the catalysts for the national inquiry. Grieving the murder of her father, her life as a happy adolescent began to spiral out of control. Addiction, self-harm, cutting school, and finally running away.
She was never provided with counseling or other cultural healing, despite ongoing assessments and recommendations that this was a critical need in her life.
I don't know how many times the door closed. I said, please just help me.
The great aunt that raised Fontaine didn't speak today, but Penrose says her concerns were largely ignored in a system that at times didn't even acknowledge her. The report makes five recommendations, including access to counseling and monitoring school attendance. The Manitoba government is reviewing it. Many of the services involved are also federally funded. The Liberal government is drafting new Indigenous child welfare legislation. As for whether enough change has already happened,
right now in my office, we have 17 young people who are at imminent risk of death or dying who need treatment urgently.
The fact that this report was released publicly does mark one change. Previously in Manitoba, reports into child welfare deaths used to be restricted to government. Tina Fontaine's death prompted a legislative change to allow them now to be released publicly, something the advocate hopes leads to greater accountability and scrutiny. Cameron McIntosh, CBC News, Saiging First Nation.
I'm Farah Murali at Bathurst and Steeles. Early this morning, a 90-year-old man was struck and killed in the McDonald's parking lot behind me here. I'll have more on just what happened coming up.
A 9-year-old man is dead after being struck by a pickup truck in a McDonald's parking lot this morning. Police are now looking into what caused the collision near Bathurst and Steeles, and they are not ruling out distracted driving as a possibility. Farah Morelli has more.
I'm here on the south side of this McDonald's restaurant. If you take a look behind me, you'll see a drive-thru with cars parked in it. What police believed happened is a truck going through that drive-thru turned right to exit towards us, and that's when it struck and killed this 90-year-old man walking through the lot. It all happened around 9:30 this morning. Investigators taped off this entire area as they tried to piece together what happened. This dark blue pickup truck was the vehicle coming through that drive-thru. The man behind the wheel actually got out of his car after the collision and tried to perform first aid on the elderly man, but he later died from what police said were head injuries. What we don't know is whether the driver of the truck saw this man or not. Police don't believe he was speeding, but they're not ruling out the possibility that the driver may have been distracted coming out of the drive-thru.
All aspects of the investigation are going to be looked at. We have some good video. We have some witnesses. The investigators will be speaking to those witnesses, getting statements, also reviewing that video. And from there, determine, I guess, if any charges are going to be laid. So right now, it's still young and fresh in the investigation.
What we also don't know is where this man was coming from and whether he was even going to the McDonald's behind me. A lot of people have been using this path just next to me here to get to the intersection of Bathurst and Steeles, because the sidewalk is actually flooded. Now, police have identified the 90-year-old man who was killed. They've notified the next of kin, but at this time, they're not releasing his name. Farah Morelli, CBC News, Toronto.
For years, we've heard the warnings, don't use your cell phone while pumping gas. They were considered a fire hazard at the pump, but now Ontario Safety Agency says they're not so dangerous after all. Hawaii Fidel explains why your phone may soon be an asset at the pump.
Most drivers have seen the signs. No smoking, no keys in the ignition, and no cell phones while filling your tank. Why?
Because it can cause a fire.
Gonna fuel is gonna be exploding.
Some drivers received some not so friendly reminders.
The gas station attendant, he was like screaming at me to shut it off.
Even a quick online search and you'll find videos like this, claiming a cell phone started a fire. Until now, it was believed that a cell phone battery was the problem. But the Technical Standards and Safety Authority is dispelling that myth after a new report was commissioned by the Canadian Fuels Association.
Cell phones were not necessarily designed to be working in a potentially explosive environment.
The report found the risk of your cell phone starting a fire at the gas pumps to be 1 in 10 billion. So the TSSA says as soon as gas stations have the technology, you can start using your phone to pay at the pumps. That was the goal of the report. The CFA wanted to give drivers the option. But still, it's urging people to pay attention while pumping and stay off their phones to avoid spills or accidents.
It's a bit like when you're driving and using your cell phone for texting and checking your emails. Not a good idea to do so.
The Ontario Safety League agrees.
And I think at the end of the day, that phone call can wait the 2 minutes it takes to fill your tank.
Hawaii Fidel, CBC News, Toronto.
Investigators are asking anyone with information to come forward after a man was shot dead inside an apartment building last night. He's been identified as 51-year-old Martin Anthony Johnson. The shooting happened just before midnight near Keel and Shepherd.
Our officers arrived on scene and they located a male victim suffering from gunshot wounds. Paramedics arrived on scene very quickly, provided medical assistance to this victim. Unfortunately, I've been told that this gentleman has been pronounced deceased.
The officers arrived at the building on Dorado Court just after 11 last night. They found the victim in a first floor hallway. Police say more than 10 gunshots had been fired. They're asking witnesses to come forward. Federal and provincial government teamed up today to announce funding to help stop gun and gang violence.
We recognize these are not simply problems that you can merely arrest your way out of, but we have to invest in our kids and in our communities to address the circumstances that give rise to violence. And that is why we have announced up to $327.6 million over a five-year period in new funding to help support a variety of initiatives and reduce gun crime and criminal gang activities across the country.
Take Action Against Gun and Gang Violence is an initiative led by both levels of government. For Ontario, the feds have put aside $65 million over the course of 5 years, and $11 million of that will be used solely on prevention, intervention, and rehabilitation.
We are making significant investments in prevention to keep our community safe. And that involves working not just with law enforcement, but also working with community organizations and working with in communities to make the changes that actually change the circumstances that often give rise to violent crime, things like poverty, unemployment, you know, poor outcomes in school, access to social and health and mental health services. All of those things can make a difference, and we're investing in all of those things.
Blair says shootings have become the most common method of homicide, with gang-related homicides almost doubling since 2013. A group of doctors want to see that change. Now, Dr. Philip Berger is one of the physicians behind Canadian Doctors for Protection from Guns. They want gun violence to be a public health issue, a stance that's garnered criticism and some formal complaints. I met with Dr. Berger at St. Michael's Hospital today to hear why doctors are wading into this debate.
In any other situation where doctors identify external conditions that are hurting people, whether it's infectious diseases, smoking, drunk driving, doctors have always intervened and made recommendations about policy which could reduce the harm to their patients. In this case, we're recommending a total ban on handguns and military assault weapons and stricter gun control legislation.
The government's actually thinking about this, we're hearing that. But why is it important for doctors to be advocating for a handgun ban?
Because doctors would rather prevent illness and injury rather than treat the consequences. So of course our role is to treat the victims of gun violence, which we do very well. But we also have a role to speak out on measures which could prevent this from happening in the first place. And one measure is reduce the access to guns. Less guns, less corpses.
You're also advocating for a public health approach to gun violence. What would that entail?
Public health approach is a classic approach where one identifies the conditions and circumstances in society, on the streets, which are making people sick. Cigarette smoking is classic. Most doctors don't smoke. Many people in the public do. We give the evidence to show that it's bad and make recommendations on how to stop smoking, prevent the consequences of smoking. Flu vaccine. Drunk driving, many examples where doctors have for over a century actually intervened in the public debate and in recommendations to government. This is no different.
Have we seen a public health approach work in other places in the world?
Absolutely. In fact, in today's Journal of American Medical Association.
Yeah, I see you brought a prop for us
there.
Yeah,
well, there's an article called Firearms Policies that work.
And is that one of the ones that
there,
work?
There are hundreds of articles in medical journals. We are the experts on public policy and gun injury. The Canadian Coalition for Firearm Rights, which oppose us, has no expertise. We study it, we see the consequences, and we make recommendations that are based on data and rational arguments.
You and some of the doctors in this group that you need to stay in your lane. That's what the gun lobby is saying to you.
We're in the lane. We're in the lane of death, injury, and trauma to families. Our group will speak and speak loudly, which is our duty as doctors, and we see conditions which are making our patients sick and hurting them. Guns are killing our patients.
Appreciate your time and your insights, Dr.
Thank
Berger.
Thank you.
If Ontario's official opposition gets their way, single-use plastic-lined coffee cups, straws, and plastic bags will be banned in this province by 2020.
For too long, we have left industry to make its own rules. We know that reducing the amount of waste destined for landfills is critical to reducing the intense levels of air, soil, and water pollution in Ontario, Canada, and the rest of the world.
The NDP's environment critic outlined his private member's bill today. It would eliminate some of the worst plastic pollutants by 2020, with all single-use plastics banned by 2025. The bill exempts products needed for people with disabilities. The Conservatives have also said they're open to looking at a single-use plastics ban. They're currently looking for input from the public and stakeholders on how to address this problem. The NDP will introduce their bill on Monday. Nick, I don't know if you saw my interview with the doctor a couple of stories ago. I wasn't wearing a jacket outside just because we were supposed to do it inside and I left my jacket in the newsroom. But we still need jackets out there. We're not that warm yet.
Yeah, I was going to say, how was it? It's It's a little deceiving when you look through the window. It looks like it's, you know, a nice, warm, sunny day, maybe spring-like. But we're slowly creeping up in temperatures. Not quite there just yet. We hit 2-3 degrees today. Did come under sunny skies, though, as you saw in the footage there. However, we are tracking that system I mentioned. It's back down to the southwest. It is developing. It's going to bring with it a few spotty showers for tomorrow, but the bulk of it for Thursday. So here's how it times out. Tomorrow afternoon, in the neighborhood of about noon to 3 p.m., we're looking at some spotty showers across the GTA. This is not heavy rainfall. It's just showers. This is going to pass through pretty quickly, and then we've got just generally cloud cover until we get to Thursday. Now, Thursday early afternoon, some leading showers with the system, but it's really Thursday night, or at least Thursday late evening, around 8, 9 p.m., where we're going to see this line of showers and potentially thunderstorms roll through the GTA. It could bring with it some locally heavy rainfalls, but in advance of it, we're also looking at warm temperatures and gusty southerly winds. The whole system doesn't last very long, though. It clears out toward the end of the week. Winds tomorrow fairly light, but you'll notice as I move this forward, look at the timestamp there, by Thursday evening, strong southerly winds, some areas up to about 80 kilometers per hour, just close to warning criteria. I'm not sure they're going to, Environment Canada will issue warnings with it, but it's going to be a windy day anyway, Thursday through Friday as well. In terms of rainfall accumulations, generally speaking, about 15 to 20 millimeters of rain in the forecast with this. Locally higher amounts, though. Right now, temperature is sitting at 2 degrees. As we look forward to the forecast there, tomorrow, highs to 5 degrees, and then that 5 degrees is actually going to stick around through Wednesday night. That's our low. Temperatures climb. Late day high of 10 degrees. This is not an afternoon high. It's a late day high of 10 degrees. 15 to 20 millimeters of rain, and then temperatures start to drop into the weekend. We've got a pair of ones for Saturday and Sunday. Dwight.
Yeah, right for the weekend. That 10, yeah, can you move
it? That's
anyway?
How it is.
Thank you, buddy.
You bet.
It is a technique that has revolutionized healthcare, robots that help perform surgeries. These machines have been in hospitals across North America for nearly two decades now. And just last month, Canada saw its first robotic knee surgery. But as Christine Birak shows us, the line between pros and cons of this process is not clear-cut.
The sound might be jarring, but orthopedic surgeon Dr. Anthony Adili is in awe. He's holding a robotic arm that's cutting into his patient's knee, a procedure he's done hundreds of times. But for the first time, he's mostly watching.
I will only cut it based on where we've modeled it.
The robotic arm precisely chisels each bone so that surgeons can cap it with a knee implant.
I'm walking fine, walking straight. I'm great. I'm so thrilled.
Just a small part of Peter Sporta's knee was damaged, but Adili says most surgeons would have done a full knee replacement to lower the risk of complications. Robotic-assisted surgery makes partial replacements easier by reducing the risk of a bad cut.
The biggest difference is the ability to accurately get the alignment of the implant exactly where you want.
More accurate, smaller incisions, less blood loss, quicker recovery times are all points used to sell robotic surgical devices. American hospitals quickly bought into the marketing nearly 20 years ago and did so without much evidence, potentially putting patients at risk.
Newer doesn't always mean better.
The U.S. Food and Drug Administration recently warned about using robotic assistance in some cancer surgeries. Researchers found some women with cervical cancer who had minimally invasive, usually robotic procedures, may not live as long as those who underwent a traditional surgery, although it's not entirely clear why.
For many procedures and many diseases, there isn't long-term data that's available to either prove the safety of robotic surgery or demonstrate that it's superior to other alternatives.
Canadian hospitals that have purchased these multi-million dollar devices have largely done so with private money. But an expert committee in Ontario actually recommended against funding the most popular robotically assisted surgery for prostate cancer.
We haven't found that cure rates are higher with the use of the robot. And then, of course, we look at things like complications. And with prostate surgery, the big complications are urinary dysfunction and sexual dysfunction. And again, there's no good evidence that using the robot reduces the rates of those complications.
Add to that, robotically assisted procedures often take longer to do and on average cost over $3,000 more per patient. Dr. Adili and his team are now gathering evidence for this new robot and an old one by conducting randomized trials.
So that way we can definitively answer these questions so we can say to the payer, there is advantage for this technology, for this subgroup of people, and these are the outcomes you can expect. That's the discussion we need. We're not there yet.
But from what he's seen so far, Sporta is sold. Christine Birak, CBC News, Hamilton, Ontario.
This isn't one I would want to see in theaters, but I can definitely see dragon lovers like my little brother really liking this one.
We've got some good ideas for the rest of March break, and these are for the little ones from our little correspondents. CBC Kids News has the best kid-friendly movie picks for you after the break.
This weather update is brought to you by Fairmont Le Chateau Frontenac, the best location for your next spring break getaway in Quebec City.
Second day of March break and already running out of activities? Well, you're in luck. Our CBC Kids News contributor Zach Boniface rounded up some kid-approved movies to keep you busy in and out of the theaters. Here are his picks.
Thinking of going to the movie theater this March break? Wondering what movies to watch? Here's our Kids March Break movie watch list to keep you up to date on all the movies you might want to check out in your time off. Probably the biggest hit coming to theaters this March break is Captain Marvel. Captain Marvel stars Brie Larson making history as Marvel's first female-led superhero movie. It also stars Samuel L. Jackson, Jude Law, and plenty of other familiar faces. It's about Carol Danvers' return to Earth to find out what the mysterious shape-shifting Skrulls are up to this time. I've already got my tickets to see this one and can't wait. This is definitely a movie that you might want to check out on your time off. Of course, there's some animated movies worth seeing too. There's the LEGO Movie 2, which is the fourth official movie produced by LEGO.
A lifetime has passed since the horrific events of Taco Tuesday.
It's the sequel to 2014's The LEGO Movie and sees the same voice cast returning while keeping the same wit and charm of the original. So, if you've liked the LEGO movies, this is definitely one you should check out. There's also How to Train Your Dragon: The Hidden World, which is the final installment in the How to Train Your Dragon trilogy.
I know this handiwork. Grimmel the Grizzly, famous back where I'm from. The smartest dragon hunter I ever met.
It's sure to provide a satisfying end to this beloved trilogy.
Wow.
It's a hidden dragon world.
This isn't one I would want to see in theaters, but I can definitely see dragon lovers like my little brother really liking this one. The last movie that might interest some in theaters is Alita: Battle Angel.
She's threatening the natural order of things.
It's the newest movie based on a Japanese manga. To me, this one looks really awesome and action-packed. If you're a fan of the original manga or of sci-fi in general, this one might be of interest to you. But if you're not big on the genre or the animation style, you probably want to stay away from this one. In case your movie theater doesn't have a couch, like the one I'm in, there's plenty of good movies to watch from the comfort of your own home. There's lots of new releases to rent on most digital platforms. The Oscar-winning Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse or the action-packed Aquaman are just a couple of the many available to rent now.
It would appear that I am stuck.
Have you just eaten honey?
I have not just eaten honey.
I wonder which way.
I always get to where I'm going by walking away from where I have been.
If you're looking for a feel-good family movie, I would recommend curling up on the couch together and watching Christopher Robin.
Oh, I do like a party.
Come on, Pig.
What should happen if you forget about
whatever you choose to watch this March break, you're sure to have a great time with any of them. Have a great week, and don't forget the popcorn. I'm Zach Boniface for CBC Kids News.
Humans aren't the only species in the archives of Ontario. I'm Talia Ricci, and coming up, I'm going to take you around Animalia. It's an exhibit that shows how animals have been documented over time.
When we research historical events, the focus is usually on humans, but an exhibit at the Archives of Ontario gives another species a time to shine. Animalia is a free exhibit that explores how animals have been documented over time and the relationship they have had with people. Talia Ricci checked it out.
This is our Animalia exhibit, Animals in the Archives, which looks at how different animals are documented in our collections and the different stories that we have in those collections.
And how far back do some of these stories and photos and videos go?
hundreds of years. We have a quote from the diary of Elizabeth Simcoe, the wife of John Graves Simcoe, the first lieutenant governor of Ontario. In her diary, she describes observing passenger pigeons from the 1790s.
Why is a focus on animals something that you wanted to do here?
Well, the great thing about animals is that everyone, if not almost everyone, loves animals. And so this was a way of kind of drawing in some new audiences to discover the amazing things that we have documented in our archival collections. We focus on five different animals: fish, bears, horses, dogs, and birds.
Now this little baby, he's kind of a cute little fellow, is exactly the same age as this puppy here, but he, as you can see, would be maybe much more suitable for a small apartment.
This was something that I was amazed when I was doing research in our collections, is that, you know, from the sort of the beginning of the invention of photography in the mid-19th century, that featuring, you know, your family dog in a photo was pretty common. And we have a lot of examples of that in our collection, including this hilarious photo of these six children who are not enjoying the photograph as much as their pet pug is.
People who are complaining about the streetcar today have clearly not experienced this.
That's right, the original horsepower, right? So this photo is from 1885. This is King Street in Toronto. This was actually how people got around in streetcars until the 1890s, when the streetcars were electrified.
Some campers, new at the game, find the bear exciting. How exciting is it for the bear?
A lot of people in Ontario, especially Indigenous communities, have a really special relationship with bears, and a lot of their stories relate to bears as well.
You can catch Animalia here at the Archives of Ontario until January 2021. Talia Ricci, CBC News, Toronto.
The Toronto Zoo's new baby zebra finally has a name. Any guesses? All right, here's a hint. It's from a galaxy far, far away. We'll have the answer for you after the break. Time for you to show us your GTA, and thanks to Levan for this incredible shot of two deer in the water at Arendelle Park in Mississauga. Love that one. Get your photos to us by posting them on Twitter or Instagram with the hashtag CBCYourGTA, and of course, we will air some of them on the show. There's the big reveal. The Toronto Zoo's new baby finally has a name. And may the force be with him. Meet Obi. Where is Obi? There is Obi behind Mommy. The stripy baby isn't the only one in the family with an out-of-this-universe name. His siblings, Leia and Rey, also have a Star Wars-themed name. The baby zebra was born last month. That's when the zoo asked you to vote on what his name should be. Obi is a Gravy's zebra, which are considered endangered and are primarily found in Kenya and Ethiopia. Obi is currently living with his mom in a barn where he likes to monkey around, kicking and leaping any chance he gets. He will make his public debut a little later this year. And no, you're not watching National Geographic. It's actually me and Nick here, weather-wise, sir.
Yeah, things are warming up, right? Mm-hmm. Maybe you can lose the jacket by Thursday. And tomorrow, not so much. Still 5 degrees in the forecast for tomorrow. It's going to be mild compared to what we've seen recently. Follows -4 tonight, and cloud cover starting to roll.
Yeah, we brought the zebra music back for you there.
I was wondering about that. Afternoon showers for tomorrow. I don't even know how to continue. With that after the music.
Sorry, buddy.
It's our new weather theme, right? 5 degrees, and then we've got double digits headed our way for Thursday. I'm going to leave it at that before I keep laughing.
It sounded like Green Acres. Remember that show? Green Acres is the place to be. Sorry about that, buddy. That's our show for tonight. Thank you for watching. We will see you back here tomorrow at 6. Have a great night, everybody. Mike Wise has you covered at 11. Good night.